Hello, everyone. Nice to meet you. This is Jae Jung Shim from Korea University Guro Hospital. I am chairman of the Korean Academy of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Disease, also general secretary in APSR 2022 Seoul Congress. I'm very honored to have an opportunity to make the presentation at VNRS 2021. Today, I'll talk about the metabolomics in COPD. Now I'm going to talk first, what's the metabolomics, and second, briefly review previous metabolomics studies in COPD, and then I'll tell you about the result of our research conducted in metabolomics in COPD. First, what's the metabolomics? The metabolomics is a measurement of the very small non-peptide metabolites that reflect pathologic stimuli, genetic modifications, and environmental exposures in body fluids, such as serum or urine. As the last product, it can be provide the insight into the disease because it reflects changes caused by the environment, such as diet and drug. In our body, when the transcription occurs in DNA, translation occurs after the RNA, it becomes the protein, and this protein is modified, and the metabolite is formed through the reaction of environment. Metabolites have a great range of changes compared to DNA, RNA, and the protein. So even though no changes was seen at the DNA, RNA, or protein level, the significant changes can be observed at the metabolite level, which is very advantageous in discovering new disease-related markers. In case of the genomics and the proteomics, it tells you what will happen, whereas metabolomics shows what actually happened under the influence of the environment, such as a drug, diet, microorganisms, pollutant, and toxic agents. Thus, this is considered to be most appropriate indicator of phenotype. Now, let's look at the metabolomics is measured. First of all, the sample is prepared, and analysis method include the nuclear magnetic resonance using the magnetic field and mass spectrometer after separation by gas or the liquid chromatography. The nuclear magnetic resonance method use the characteristics that the proton resonance in high magnetic field. It is fast and non-destructive because it does not separate metabolite, but it has a disadvantage of low sensitivity. On the other hand, the mass spectrometry measures the known intrinsic mass to change ratio mass of the substance after ionization of a metabolite and the separation by gas or the liquid chromatography. The advantage of a mass spectrometry is the increased sensitivity. Grouping is performed for the data analysis. Using the statistical methods such as PCA and PLSDA to see the pattern of whether the distribution of these metabolites shows a difference between each group and whether the two groups can be classified well. Among the substances showing the significant difference, the substance showing a clinical meaningful pathway is accurately identified by the quantifying the verified impurity concentration by the comparing with the standard product. After validation of whether the substance is meaningful as a biomarker experimentally or in the other groups is done. It is possible to discover the certain metabolite as a biomarker for disease. Now I will tell you about the previous published major metabolomics COPD studies. For the COPD studies are using the integration of non-metabolic variables such as comorbidities, medications, pulmonary function test, and demographic data with metabolomics-based biomarkers to the phenotype COPD. Metabolomic researchers have indicated that the dysfunction of amino acid metabolism and lipid metabolism and energy production pathways, and the imbalance of the oxidations and antioxidations might lead to local and systemic inflammation by activating the NF-kappa-B signal pathway and releasing inflammatory cytokines such as IL-6, TNF-alpha, and IL-8. In addition, they might cause protein malnutrition, oxidative stress, and contribute to the development and exacerbation of COPD. Here I will introduce one COPD metabolic studies published in Blue Journal in 2015. All those sphingolipids as a class are implicated in the pathogenesis of COPD. The particular sphingolipid species associated with the COPD subphenotypes remain unknown. The aim of this study was to determine which plasma sphingolipids are associated with a subphenotype of COPD by using mass spectrometry. All subjects were from the COPD gene cohort. From this cohort, the study selected a subset of 129 subjects for the targeted sphingolipid analysis. Additionally, 1,031 subjects who participated in microarray study of gene expression in peripheral blood mononuclear cells were selected for the untargeted sphingolipid analysis. The most statistically significant negative association between specific COPD phenotype and the sphingolipid classes was for the emphysema and the sphingomyelin myelins. The most statistically significant positive association was between COPD exacerbation and 3-hexosylceramides. Plasma sphingomyelins were lower in emphysema, and plasma ceramides were the inversely associated with emphysema severity. ROC curve analysis and AUC for the sphingolipids significantly associated with moderate COPD exacerbations. The first model used only the demographic and clinical covariates, including covariate age, sex, smoking status, body mass index, and FEV1. The second model includes the same covariates and added the plasma level of ceramide, which was a sphingolipid that most improved ROC. This study investigated the association of the plasma sphingolipids with COPD subtypes such as airflow obstruction, emphysema, chronic bronchitis, and frequent exacerbation in well-characterized cohort of current or former smokers. These findings added to the previous studies reporting association of sphingomyelin and ceramides with airflow obstruction and emphysema. In addition, this study identified novel sphingolipids associated with COPD phenotypes, such as frequent COPD exacerbations. Study showed that the COPD subphenotype are associated with the dysregulated gene metabolite pathways for the sphingolipids, adding the further evidence to their role in the pathogenesis of COPD. Next, I will tell you about the research we conducted. First, we performed the metabolomics research for the asthma COPD overlap. As you know, the ECHO is a disease that boasts asthma and COPD characteristics. SMS or PD or ACO is heterogeneous and cannot be clearly distinguished. The term of ACO should be discarded when other phenotypes or endotypes are identified. So even though ACO is heterogeneous, so you are trying to classify the patients with the term of ACO among the COPD, because the classification is helpful to considering which COPD patients should be used the ICS. The use of ICS is recommended mainly in patients with airflow limitations, airway mucosal edema, or eosinophilic airway inflammation. The aim of our study was to understand the pathophysiology of ACO and to select who will get the benefit from the ICS treatment. So we conducted a metabolomics study for ACO. 107 asthma, COPD, and ACO patients were treated, and the urine metabolite was analyzed by the liquid mass spectrometry. First of all, let's briefly talk about the cohort conducted the study. The Korea ACO cohort is a cohort established for the purpose of discovering biomarkers for diagnosis and monitoring of asthma. COPD and ACO in Korea University Guro Hospital, St. Mary's Hospital, and the Jeonbuk National University Hospital. We collect the baseline information, lung function, questionnaire scores, and blood urine samples. ACO definition was classified according to the Spanish guideline algorithm. The collected urine samples were processed and liquid chromatography coupled with a high resolution mass spectrometry was used to analyze the change and fluctuation of all metabolites in the urine samples of patients with chronic airway disease. This slide was shown the baseline characteristics. The age was the lowest in the asthma group, and the male ratio was also the lowest in the asthma group. In COPD and ACO groups, by definition, all patients were smokers. Comorbidities showed no difference except for the allergic rhinitis. Lung function was lower in COPD and ACO than asthma, and the BDR was the highest in ACO. All renal functions were within the normal range, and there was no difference in creatinine between the three groups. Urine L-histidine were found to be clinically significant. As you know, histidine is a precursor of the histamine involved in airway inflammation and the substance involved in airway smooth muscle contraction and inflammatory responses. Urinary L-histidine intensity was significantly higher in ACO compared with asthma or COPD. There is no detailed difference in histidine level according to the origin of ACO. Slide was shown the correlation between the urinary L-histidine and SGRQ, ACT, BDR, FEV1, and FEV1-FVC ratio. Throughout the diagnosis of ACO and look back at the consensus that the ICS should be used in airway disease, it is when ACO is suspected, which includes first the BDR 400 ml or higher or asthma history is present, and second BDR 200 ml or 10% more checked in twice. And third is the peripheral eosinophil count is 300 or higher. Among these cases, the required ICS, there also included the frequent exacerbator. After removing diagnosis of patients with airflow obstruction and see the result according to these criteria, urinary L-histidine levels were higher in those with BDR 400 ml and asthma history on the first criterion than those without. Also, the urinary L-histidine levels were higher in the group with more than the 12 or the BDR 200 ml more than 2 times checked than the dose without. Urinary L-histidine was also elevated in those with eosinophilia. Therefore, when the group with the frequent excavation and the group without the frequent excavation was compared. Histidine was also measured high in frequent excavators. Urinary L-histidine intensity was measured to be high in frequent excavators. Normally, the high urinary L-histidine was also the significant parameter in echo even after the adjusting for the factors such as age, gender, and smoking. In conclusion, urinary metabolomics showed that asthma, COPD, and echo have different metabolites, and among them, the urinary L-histidine could be a candidate biomarker for detecting people who need ICS. Further studies, including the quantitative analysis and the proteomics and genomics studies, are necessary to confirm the diagnostic value of urinary L-histidine and to elucidate the underlying mechanism. Okay, now my second study is for the tuberculosis-related COPD. Although smoking is considered the main cause of COPD, several other risk factors, including tuberculosis, contribute significantly to disease causations, particularly in developing countries. However, the underlying pathogenesis of TB-related COPD is unclear. Moreover, the need of prompt diagnosis and treatment of the TB-related COPD to decrease the future burden of the inflammation is underestimated. This study aims to identify distinctive endogenous metabolites of TB-related COPD compared to smoking-associated COPD. At baseline, the higher level of the IL-6 and the CRP and the SGRQ scores were seen in the TB-COPD group compared to those in the smoking-related COPD group. Cross-sectional metabolomic analysis and clinical examinations of serum samples were performed for the three groups of 168 male subjects. 59 TB-related COPD, 60 smoking-related COPD, and 39 healthy normal controls. To retain the broader spectrum of metabolites, we performed both global metabolomic profiling, LC-QTOF mass spectrometry, and targeted analysis using LC-MS mass spectrometry. By targeted analysis, elevated aspartate and decreased serotonin, significant markers for the TB-COPD. Overall metabolomic profiling showed elevated metabolites, including arachidonic acid and eicosanoic acid in the TB-COPD group. Typical changes in tryptophan catabolism were observed through the targeted profiling. Additionally, in the TB-COPD group, kynurenine was elevated and the serotonin level was reduced. Therefore, IDO, TPH activities were dysregulated. The metabolism of fatty acid, especially arachidonic acid and eicosanoic acid, and tryptophan catabolism were correlated, particularly in the TB-COPD groups. These results are consistent with the finding of elevated inflammatory markers such as IL-6 and CRP in TB-related COPD group, demonstrating the association between systemic inflammation in TB-related COPD. Patients with TB-related COPD have enhanced inflammatory responses that may link to fatty acid pathways and tryptophan catabolism, which could be novel therapeutic target for the TB-COPD. Slide is my last slide. In summary, the metabolomics is a snapshot more detailed phenotype of patients' heterogeneity. Previous metabolic studies in COPD could validate role as a biomarker and as a potential contributor to COPD pathogenesis. Our experience of metabolomics study in COPD about the urine biomarkers for the ACO and the pathogenetic contributor for the TB-related COPD would be helpful for the understanding various phenotypes of COPD.
Thank you for your attention. I would like to invite you to the APSR 2002 Seoul Congress. See you in Seoul next year. Thank you.